Good morning. This is Wednesday, 10 o'clock, so it's time for another Fireside Chat with the expert. Today, I have the pleasure to introduce my good friend and colleague, David Krudhoff, who's going to be talking about counterfeit components and how we can find them using x-rays. So yours, David.
Thanks, Bill. Happy to be joining this morning. Pretty exciting topic for us here at Creative Electron. Bill said we're going to be talking about 10 ways to find counterfeit electronic components using x-ray. Counterfeit components in Creative Electron go a long way back, a long history of helping our customers mitigate the risk with counterfeits. And more recently, not even just with electronic components, right? Finding counterfeit batteries, counterfeit handbags even. We do a lot of work with counterfeit different things, but today we're going to be talking about electronic components in particular. So first, I want to answer the question, why is this so important, right? Why do we keep talking about this? Why does it need to be addressed, right? So this really came to the front stage, so to speak, about 10 years ago. Senators Brown and Carper brought this up, that counterfeit parts were infiltrating the DoD, infiltrating military airplanes and things like that. So this is obviously very critical. It's not just a threat, you know, it's not just a possibility, it's definitely a reality. These kinds of things are really happening. They're really around, and we need to make sure that we're addressing this kind of problem. So how does the electronic component supply chain work? You have your OCMs, which are the original component manufacturers. These are the Intels, the Xilinx of the world. These companies are making components, they're manufacturing them, and then they want to sell them on the market. So they have franchise distributors, right? These are authorized distributors. These are the big guys. They're only buying parts from these OCMs, so they know they're getting good stuff. And they're reselling it, usually in volume, to their customers. But when they get to kind of the end of their stock, the end of the run for these components, they sell their excess stock to independent distributors. These are the next tier guys, and this is the start of the gray market, we call it. This is where, you know, you don't really know, you as the end user don't really know where the independent distributor got these components from. They could be legitimate. They could be counterfeit, depending on where they bought it and if they're being checked or not, right? That's what we want to talk about. There's also brokers. These are people who generally don't stock components, but they their customers come to them and say, hey, I need a component ABC 123, right? Then this broker will go out and talk to all these independent distributors and try to find the components. They'll source them for their customers and they'll bring it to them. And then after that is the aftermarket manufacturer. These are companies that actually will make essentially obsolete components. The OCM today, we're not going to make these anymore. Doesn't make enough money for us. But there's still some demand. So these aftermarket manufacturers will step in and make them at obviously a much higher price per piece. So sometimes it's authorized by the OCM. Sometimes they're doing reverse engineering. Various ways of them going about that. But all of these are servicing the contract manufacturers, the original equipment manufacturers of the world. So that's kind of how that supply chain works in a nutshell. So what's going on with counterfeits? Counterfeits are definitely increasing as demand increases for parts. But a couple years back, there's a huge shortage of capacitors, small component, but because there was such a huge demand for them and not enough legitimate supply, counterfeiters came and stepped in, right? So counterfeit components are definitely increasing. Also, there's the replacement of military equipment out in the field. And these military equipment is always it's something that they want to replace, make it exactly the same because they knew it worked that time. So maybe 20 years later, right, they still want to make this this device, or they want to repair a device and they need these obsolete components for that. DoD budget cuts obviously cause some issues here, right? If the DoD is not investing in new technology and advancing new devices for military use, they have to use their old stuff. If they're going to be using their old stuff, then they have to use obsolete components. Also, longer delivery times is another issue. Like I mentioned with the capacitors, there's a definite shortage of tantalum capacitors in particular. Lead times were just getting crazy. So that makes people more desperate. When you're desperate for something, you're willing to cut some corners, and that may lead to problems with getting some counterfeit parts in there. Also, counterfeiters are getting better, right? They start off by just sanding down the markings and painting something on with some cheap paint. And then people started catching on to that. So then counterfeiters had to step up their game, and then anti-counterfeiters had to step up their game. It's just back and forth that we're always playing. Just like with any criminal enterprise. A lot of OCMs are making components specifically for military use, and they're making a commercial side of that as well. And so some of these counterfeiters are taking those commercial ones that don't have the ruggedness that military will need, and they're selling them as a military part, even though they're not actually that part. And then, as counterfeiters, as people realize that this criminal endeavor is something that makes them money, they're exploring new ways to do it, right? So it's entering not just military applications, definitely entering commercial, automotive, and medical as well. So there's a lot of misconceptions out there regarding counterfeits, so I just want to go over a couple of them now. The first one I talked about a little bit is that it's not a chance, not a high enough chance that I need to worry about it in my day-to-day manufacturing. But actually, independent distributors have reported that anywhere from 0.5% to 35% of their product is suspect, or what they're receiving. 0.5% doesn't sound like a lot, but when you consider the numbers of components that's going through there, that adds up pretty quick. And of course, as you approach the 35% mark, that's a big chunk of the components that are out there. Another misconception is that only bad distributors or only the bad guys are going to sell me counterfeit components. But actually, a lot of these independent distributors, if they're not checking their stock, they could be very well-meaning. They're just not doing the due diligence. And so they're reselling counterfeit components without doing a thorough enough check. Another point is that only expensive components are counterfeited. And maybe that's where it started, but nowadays it's pretty much anything. As I mentioned earlier, the counterfeits are the capacitors from a couple years ago, right? Those were pretty cheap. Well, they started very cheap, and then as demand, as supply was not meeting demand, cost was going up. But still, they're relatively low cost components that counterfeiters were going after to try to earn a buck. And finally, a lot of people believe that electrical tests will pass, will prove the authenticity of components, but that's just not the case. More than half of counterfeit components have a die with very similar functionality, or a capacitor might have the same values, but it's not well built as what it's advertised to be. So the roots of the problem, kind of mentioned this, but basically the surplus stock of legitimate electronic components that these big franchise distributors don't want to deal with anymore. They have to sell them to somebody. So that creates these independent distributors, the brokers, who essentially become this gray market. And once you have that established, now it can be flooded with counterfeits. And so that's kind of how it starts, right? We also have a huge amount of scrap electronics that we just generate in consumer electronics. And environmentally, we don't want to just throw them in a landfill. So then what do? Well, you ship them off to somebody and you end up harvesting components from there. And then again, you're in this gray area. Components being made obsolete, that's a huge problem, right? Intel doesn't want to make a processor from 10 years ago. There's not enough demand for it, even 5 years ago, right? They want to move on to the latest and greatest technology so that they can compete with their competitors. It just doesn't make financial sense to be making old components that hardly anyone needs. So of course, delivery time, mentioned that already. And buyers at all the contract manufacturers and even OEMs are looking to reduce cost, right? That's their job. They're probably given bonuses for that kind of thing. So they're always trying to look for lower priced items on the market, and that includes components. And when you start cutting costs, you introduce the possibility of introducing counterfeits. So here we have a picture of component harvesting. I mentioned the scrap PCBs, right? Here's, I believe this was taken in China. You can see a man here who, he's just working in this sink or metal bowl. There's a heat gun right here, and it's just blowing heat down. He's got a hot glove on, and he's just reflowing these components, picking them off with the tweezers there and putting them into these teacups. And he's going to take those, you know, a full teacup there and sell it to somebody who buys them, right? And then who knows what they're going to do. So, you know, this is pros and cons. Great, it's not going to the landfill, but the question is, where is it going? What's happening with these things? Who's buying them and who's selling them as what? Are they labeled properly? That kind of thing. So we had a visitor a couple of months back who had a very good discussion with Bill about this very matter, because it's Scotty from Strange Parts. I don't know if you're familiar with the channel. If you're not, I highly recommend checking it out. It's pretty awesome. In this case, he had built his own Galaxy S9 Plus from parts in China that were available in a market. He built his own phone. He wanted to come here and check it out and compare it to a one he bought at the Best Buy down the street and just look at the differences, right? See if he was getting counterfeit components or authentic ones, those kinds of things. But he's seen that guy in the previous slide, maybe not that person, right? But he's seen these people harvesting components. So he had a different perspective. So I'm just gonna play this video. A portion of it. It's about 3 minutes long, but as I mentioned before, I recommend checking out the whole thing.
Want to go count some parts?
Yeah, let's go count some parts and look at some counterfeit parts.
So, as you know, a lot of military aerospace applications stay in the market for, you know, an aircraft. It stays in operation for 20, 25, sometimes 30 years, right? Sure. The big challenge that these companies have, you know, they make an airplane in the 80s, is to be able to buy parts from the 80s, because as you know, they become obsolete really fast.
Sure.
And what happens is it becomes a nightmare to keep the equipment going after all the parts become obsolete. That gives a huge open field for criminals to come up with counterfeit parts.
Right.
So we have one example here.
I like to call them creative entrepreneurs.
I call them criminals. So this is a very interesting component. This is a Samsung SDRAM part. It's $90 per component. So a reel of these parts, right, comes with 1,000 components, so that's $90,000. Mm-hmm. So with $90,000 for a reel of components, that gives you the incentive for the creative entrepreneurs, right?
Well, and not only that, you don't have to counterfeit each one.
You don't.
You can counterfeit just a few.
Yep.
And make your margin just on that. And they can be mostly real.
Yeah, exactly.
With a few extra ones, and now you've made, you know, at least a few hundred extra bucks.
Exactly.
Just even replacing a couple.
Yeah. What the counterfeiters love to do is to remove components, right, from a board like this one. They remove the component with a hot air gun.
Yep.
They remove it. Mm-hmm. They clean the pads, and then they remark with the part that you're looking for. So it's a phenomenally lucrative enterprise.
Yeah.
You want to take a look what this looks like?
So just to be clear, I've seen some folks that do this sort of thing in person.
I would imagine.
So you see people in the markets pulling chips off boards. And to be really clear, like, that's not the majority of what they do. The more legit folks will take parts off boards and then just re-reel them. Right.
Yeah.
And so then, you know, or put them in trays or whatever the standard packaging is, because sometimes these parts are actually out of, you know, no longer being manufactured and are valuable.
Yeah. Counterfeiting is misrepresentation, right?
Yes. Right.
If you pull something out of a board and you sell to me and you tell me you pull out of a board,
hey, this is a used chip. I re-reeled it.
It's perfectly fine.
Yep.
Yeah.
And you might be thankful because that might be the only place you can get that chip. Place. Right? Yeah. You may not be able to buy a new one anymore.
Absolutely. Yeah. Now, you came to us with the challenge, right?
Yeah.
To find which one was the bad S9.
Right.
Now,
well, not bad. Not bad.
Not bad.
Which one was refurbished?
I didn't say which one is good or bad.
That's true.
So can you tell which one is the fake component? There's
if
some good
none
parts
of them are
mixed
real.
With the, some bad parts.
So I'm going to guess just based on the chip markings that this one is different from the rest. But I don't see any other differences. Yeah.
Let's go check it out.
And so you just put this flat on the table in the answer.
Just put it from the table for this quick analysis.
Oh, that's so cool.
Yeah,
so look at that.
So, you know, he had a little bit different perspective, right? He's been there. He's been in China. He's seen people harvesting components. And as he
some of the people replied that the sound might not be, they couldn't hear the dialogue. Would you mind just describing quickly what the discussion was at the video?
Yeah. So sorry about that. What Scotty is saying is that he's been in China, right? He's been there. He's physically seen people pull these components off the board. And really the question of is it criminal or not is what they do with them afterwards. So he was saying that, you know, some people will pull these components off and they'll re-reel them and then they'll sell them. And as long as you're selling them as components that were reworked, right? You tell them, hey, this is the component. I pulled it off of a board and I'm reselling it to you. And that's fine, right? And even as Bill was saying, you know, appreciate that, right? Because there's no other way to get that component anymore. If it's obsolete, it's obsolete now. So that person's actually adding value to the supply chain. But if you were to take that component and say, hey, here's a reel of brand new components I found, that's counterfeit, right? Now he's misrepresenting what happened. Of course, if he goes a step further and grinds off the markings and relabels them as something else, obviously counterfeit, right? He's marking them as something that they're definitely not. There's different levels to this, but the point is that you know, the guy who's doing it here, as we saw on the last slide, he's probably just, you know, honest guy, right? It's what happens after he sells those components to the next guy who re-reels them and then it finally makes it back to America and gets put on a military aircraft or inside of a missile, right? That's where we need to have full transparency about where that component has been and what's been doing. I think that's a pretty good summary. And really what I'm saying in this slide as well is that, you know, as long as you tell people what you did, where you got it from, that's great. That's even helpful to the supply chain. But when you start misrepresenting what you did, then that's criminal, right? That's counterfeit. That's a problem. So what do we do to protect ourselves? There's a lot of options. And here we have a list of, you know, your cost investment increases or decreases the likelihood of having counterfeit components. So tier one is visual inspection, looking at the packaging, looking at the labels, making sure the barcodes actually match what they say. OCMs are going to be very thorough in their process, making sure that everything is accurate and perfect and tested and all those kinds of things. Counterfeiters are usually looking for a quick buck, so they're not going to be investing in the high quality packaging. So visual inspection is your cheapest, your first line of defense. Looking at the box that came in, the bag that it's in, the tubes, the trays, all those kinds of things. Then of course, inspecting the component itself, are there any, you know, lines on it, things like that. Clearly someone scraped things off. Try to clean off the markings, those kinds of things. But the point today is we want to talk about X-ray inspection, right? If you want to go further, you can decapsulate the component. You can look at XRF to make sure the right alloys are on there. Do electrical test, material analysis of the encapsulant. Of course, other methods, you can go a lot further if you really need to make sure that is an authentic component as best as you can. But today we're going to talk about X-ray inspection. So you know, in these chats, we've kind of talked about X-ray in general, so I'll do this real quick. But X-ray inspection, discovered in 1895 by Röntgen. And here's a great picture we have hanging up in the office. Two gentlemen looking at things under X-ray. This little glass device here in the middle, this is the X-ray source. This blasting X-ray is all over the room. Zero shielding between this gentleman's head and that source, right? There's nothing protecting them. But here, this gentleman is looking at his hand through a fluoroscope. Pretty neat, probably really awesome, actually. But yeah, he's just, it's the hand here is creating a shadow on the fluoroscope that he's looking at through this device. This gentleman here has a fluorescent material here, again, casting a shadow. He's looking down at a mirror underneath to see that display. So these are the young pioneers of X-ray. Didn't realize how dangerous it was at the time, but doing some cool stuff, and we're reaping the benefits today. So principles of X-ray, you have a sample, you have a source, you have a sample in between. X-rays are a photon, it's light, it just penetrates things a lot better than our typical visible lights. So the closer your sample is to the source, the bigger that shadow is gonna be on the sensor. So you get more magnification. That's what this little animation is showing us. So what does a component look like under X-ray? Here's a little diagram on the left here. So you can see the leads coming out of the component. This is that epoxy or plastic body mold material. You have the dye, which is really the brains of the whole thing in the middle. And then you have a lead frame within it and some wire bonds. Typically those are gold. Sometimes they're aluminum, and copper is becoming more common nowadays to reduce cost. But so what you can see here under X-ray, you have this light gray rectangle here. That's the epoxy mold. That's the body of the component. You have the leads all coming out on the two sides. This is a dip. Your dye in the middle here, and you can make out the wire bonds that are connecting that dye to the lead frame that then goes out and connects with the board outside of it. So hopefully that gives you a little explanation if you're not familiar with looking at components under X-ray. Those are the different parts of it that you want to take a look at. So what do we do? How do we do this, right? Pretty much all the guidelines out there will allow for 100% X-ray and even recommend at least a large sample size of X-ray of a reel of components. So how do we identify them? One, you can compare it to another part currently in use by your customer. So that means you know that this one's good, you know that this one works. Take an X-ray image of that and compare it to the reel under inspection. You can also compare it to previous lots from a trusted supplier. So if you know that you got some from a good supplier who either checks them themselves or they're a franchise distributor, you can compare your current reel, your reel under inspection to those. You do have to be careful because manufacturers can change the lead frame or the die size or even the wire bonding scheme. All these kinds of things can change between lots and manufacturing sites. So you have to make sure that all of that is consistent when you're comparing a lot you have to another reel of components. And finally, you can compare within the same lot or within that reel. You can compare the entire reel to itself and make sure that they are consistent. Because a component manufacturer is never going to vary these things I just mentioned. They're not going to vary those within that one reel. That's not how it's done. So if there's any discrepancies amongst that, that's definitely a red flag for you. So let's go through an example here. We have a capacitor. These all look exactly the same, they look legitimate. The plastic wrapping around it tells you the measurements on it, gives you all the information you expect to have. But when you X-ray them, you can see these differences, right? The connection from the outside to the inside of the capacitor is very different. Just the material, there's several differences here that are very clear. If you were looking at one lot of components and you saw these two images pop up, you'd know, yeah, something's wrong. something's going on here. This is not not direct from the manufacturer. And if you take a look or closer look at the leads coming out, a reference or a brand new component is going to have very consistent tinning across it. The shafts of the pins are going to be very consistent, right? Very clean. This one here just looks reworked. It looked like they heated it and pulled it off of a board. So you have a little bit of a fillet remaining here on the side. Now, again, lazy, right? The pins themselves are kind of bent up. So these are all signs that this component wasn't just manufactured at the OCM and given to you. Something happened between then. And if you were told this is a new component, you know, you definitely want to flag that. So here's some tape of a Chemed tantalum low ESR capacitors. From the outside, the markings all look good. Tape, everything looks fine. But when you bring them under X-ray, you can tell the internal structure of these capacitors is drastically different. So again, if you were to see these two images in the same reel of components, that's definitely a bad sign. You want to be highly suspicious of that reel and set it aside. Another example is these memory chips that we talked about with Scotty. These are the ones we were showing him. Again, from the outside, the markings look pretty good. You know, lot codes match, those kinds of things. But when you X-ray them, very different lead frames, right? And this is an expensive component. So if all of these ones are legitimate and they just swapped out a couple of them, you know, a handful of them throughout the reel, you know, they could have made $500 there just in doing that. So it's important that you inspect all of them, all the entire reel. So as the title says in this one, we want to talk about 10 ways to find counterfeit components using X-rays. First one is an empty package, right? These are dummy components. These are legitimate components. But once they're mislabeled or relabeled as something that should have a body inside of them, that's counterfeit. So these empty ones are used as dummy components for like solder training and stuff like that. So they're easily purchased online. Several companies that make these kinds of things. Next is anomalies within the lot. Talked about this, but if you have, suddenly a change in the lead frame or an empty one in the middle, right? That's clearly a sign of suspect reel. Differences from a known good sample, right? And as I mentioned, you need to make sure the lot code matches, date code, part number, all of these things match because manufacturers might vary it from different manufacturing locations. They might change the lead frame a little bit because one manufacturer specializes in a certain strategy where the other one has different capabilities. But the components are going to function the same, just inside of it, they're different. So when you are comparing to a known good sample, you have to make sure that all of these factors match as well before comparing the X-ray image. Another one that's kind of fun, pinout mismatch. If you look at the X-ray here of this component, you can pick out a few things, right? I can't tell you all the different logic that's going into these different pins, but I can tell you that this is the voltage supply for this component, right? It's got a larger trace, it's going it actually splits into two. If you were to take a closer look here, there's probably four wire bonds to the components and just one per line. So that's the voltage in. This one clearly has no connection. It doesn't go anywhere, it's obvious. And this one down here is your ground because it's going to the ground of the die. There we go. And if you were to lay over the diagram that you received from the manufacturer, it tells you that this one should be your voltage in. But clearly, it's not going anywhere. So if you were to apply voltage to this, it's not going to turn on your component. And also on the diagram, it says this side is your ground. And clearly, it's not. So these are the kinds of signs, another way that you can quickly tell if a component is legitimate or counterfeit. Another thing is missing wire bonds. And as I mentioned, if they're aluminum or the copper, they're going to be a little bit harder to see under X-ray. So you might want to turn down your X-ray power to take a closer look. But obviously, if there's no wire bonds inside, it's highly suspect. Speaking of wire bonds, if there's internal defects with those, for instance, on this one, this spot right here is missing the bond. It's actually loose hanging out up here. So internal defects like that, yes, it could be a manufacturing issue, but those are extremely unlikely in a legitimate source. External defects. If you have to reball a component or if it's being mishandled in packaging, again, legitimate components coming straight from the manufacturer to you shouldn't ever come out of the tube or out of the tray. They should come in very good condition. If they came out of those tubes or trays, then the question is why, what happened? Right. BGA voids, again, manufacturers have a very pristine environment that they're doing this process in. Very, very low voiding, if anything, connecting the ball to the component. I've been to a site in Orange County that does reballing of components in a legitimate way. They tell the military customers that these are, you know, how it's all handled. But it's not a great environment. There's going to be some voiding here. And if people are doing these things in a shady counterfeit way, it's probably going to be even a lower quality environment. You're going to have some voiding. So that's definitely a sign you want to keep a lookout for. Bent pins. Talked a little bit about this before, but if you're handling things properly, if they're keeping them in their original packaging, you shouldn't have this issue. So if you find bent pins on your components, you got to look at the supply chain. Where do they come from? And finally, number 10, excess dye attached voiding. If there's, again, these things at the manufacturer side are done very, very pristine environments, really good clean rooms, really controlled processes. So if you're finding these large voids, one, even if it did come from the OCM, you don't want to be using it. This is a problem. But you also don't want to be, you know, this should be something that's suspect. It wasn't handled well between manufacturer and getting to you. So I know we're a little bit late, but just in summary, right, counterfeit components are seen everywhere, all the value chains, all the supply chains. So it's not just the high-end ones, not the bad ones. And a good manufacturing process starts with a good incoming inspection. So you should be doing this. You should be checking these things or hiring a trusted distributor who will do it for you. You know that everything coming from them has been x-rayed, has been inspected. And good part suppliers are susceptible to counterfeits, right? So you need to do audits with them, work with them, know that they are working on it, and even double checking, right? And the cost of having counterfeits on your board, finding them after the assembly process is very costly, especially if they go too into use, right? Whereas the cost of a good x-ray inspection is not that high. So if you have any more questions, definitely reach out to us. Visit our website. You know, we have a lot of resources on there about this, but we're also happy to talk to you.
All right. Thanks so much for your time, David. Great presentation. Yeah. And you guys, if you have any kind of questions, you can email us at info@creativeelect.com or give us a call, 760-752-1192. Thanks so much, and stay tuned. Next Wednesday, we're going to have another Fireside Chat with the experts. So you can you should have the invitation on your Google Calendar. And if not, you can email us same place, info@creativeelect.com, and make sure that you get an invitation to join. Thanks so much, and see you guys next week.
Thanks, Bill.
Creative Electronics.